This evening on The Rock Newman Show, I discuss the push for DC statehood as we near Election Day and get the opinions of political power players on both sides of the argument. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. On November 8th, D.C. residents will not only vote for the next president of the United States, but also whether the city should become America's 51st state. A new campaign, Statehood Yes, is in full swing and is working to put pressure on D.C. residents to cast their vote in favor of statehood, as well as push Congress members to carry out their cause. Beverly L. Perry serves as senior advisor to D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser, and she's in favor of D.C. statehood. Also on the yes side of the argument is Dr. Bernard Demczuk, a 40-year D.C. resident and assistant vice president for D.C. government relations at George Washington University. On the opposing end of this issue is Andrew Clark, managing editor at the Independent Journal Review. They join me now to share their views on Statehood Yes campaign, the likelihood of D.C. statehood becoming a reality, and how the legislation would affect D.C. residents. Welcome to the show to each of the three of you. Thank you so much, Ms. Perry.
Thank you.
Andrew, Bernard.
Nice to see you, Rob.
Thank you so much for being here on the Rock Newman Show.
Of course.
Okay, so this issue of D.C. statehood has been something that has been discussed now for decades. Andrew, I'm actually going to go to you first, because you have a contrary view of our other two guests, where you don't support the DC becoming the 51st state. And I'd like to go right to you and ask you why.
Sure. Well, you know, I'd like to say I'm happy to be here, and I am a D.C. resident, and I'd like to begin by saying I am totally on board with the idea of giving D.C. residents the congressional voting representation. Obviously, you know, as a D.C. resident, I would like to be represented in Congress. Also, as a conservative, you know, I'm guessing you can guess how I feel about taxation, let alone taxation without representation. That's a grave injustice, and it's not fair, and it really goes against the core of what our country was founded on. But that being said, if we agree that's the common goal of how can we get residents of D.C. representation in Congress, there is a easy way to go about this, an easier way, and a very difficult and a very hard way. Our officials in City Hall are once again trying to pick the difficult and hard way. So let's start with the idea that, as you mentioned, that the idea of D.C. statehood is not new. This has been tried time and time again, and whenever it gets to Congress, it either is voted down or it's ignored altogether. And there's actually a bipartisan consensus, if you will, almost against D.C. statehood, because yes, you have Republicans voting against it, but you also have Democrats voting against it as well. And President Obama, while he has said he supports the idea of it, has not been nearly as supportive as I think the mayor's office would have hoped during this administration. So there's two reasons why Congress does not really want to pick up this political football, if you will. The first one, and as I'm sure Professor Bernard here will talk about later on, are the constitutional arguments. As far as the constitutionality of D.C. statehood, it's murky at best. Anyone who says that this is a cut and dry, constitutionally permissible activity is merely offering speculation, because the courts have never been asked this question before. The courts have ruled a bunch of times about D.C.'s status, and more often than not, they have ruled against D.C. trying to assert itself as having state-like qualities. The other challenge is that in the Constitution itself, the language is very clear about what the federal district is supposed to be and how Congress is supposed to have control over that. So for that reason alone, Congress has not been excited to pick up this issue, because it might be dead on arrival in the courts. But let's assume that Congress does pass the D.C. statehood bill anyway. It will almost certainly be challenged in the courts after it's done. And then we're looking at a years-long protracted battle that will cost a lot of money. Emotions will certainly run high in the district and in Congress and across the country. And at some point, there's no guarantee that we would even get the goal that we want. So that's the chief reason why this D.C. statehood push, again, is the long shot and the hard, difficult way, and it's not the best way for residents to be using their energy and their time and their money.
Before I go to either of the other two guests, I want to ask you something, because you said something. You said political football. You pick up this before it picks up this political football, and I think in a piece that you wrote, you talked about sort of practicality and pragmatism, that Republicans won't like it or support it because it would likely give Democrats another vote. Now, when you juxtapose what they like with what is good for the citizenry of the District of Columbia, isn't that a rather sort of weak and somewhat morally corrupt position to take, that just because?
Sure, no, so if you, I was gonna finish, the point I was gonna make is that there is a difficult way to get this done. In my opinion, DC officials are picking the difficult way. Mm-hmm. There is an easier way. I'm not saying it's easy, it's easier. And this idea has been floated around before, is that if DC residents truly, if the goal is only to give DC residents two senators and a congressman or congresswoman in Congress, you can cede parts of the district back to Maryland or Virginia. That's obviously not a very emotionally inspiring idea, because we do have this identity as the District of Columbia, but that would be the much easier way to get it done. And on the politics front, the reason I said it's a political football is that, yes, pragmatically, Republicans in Congress would not like the idea of having two new Democratic senators in the Senate. I do think that if the roles were somehow switched, Democrats would be offering arguments against a similar proposition. It's obviously a very tense partisan time that we're living in. The Senate, you know, after this election, will either be a plus one or minus one control, depending on who wins the election. And I think that you'd find that of the 300 million people who live in this country, if they're posed with this question, do we want to do this? You're not just asking the question of should we give DC residents two senators, you're saying, do I want to shift the balance of Senate against or in my favor? So I think the whole question, when it gets introduced on the national level, becomes way more complicated and way more complex and emotional than the district can handle. So back to my original point, with the Maryland-Virginia retrocession idea, is it constitutional? I'm not sure. But that does take out the political football aspect of this question. It gets everyone their representation in Congress, and it's a easy compromise way to get everyone what they want, okay, without ruffling any feathers.
Before I go to Ms. Perry, who is has been very involved in the process of getting this on the ballot, let me go to Bernard, who I know has Dr. Demczuk, who I know has been working in the district for 40 some years, now several decades, on the issue, working on supporting the issue of DC statehood. We sit here in the middle of Washington, DC, on the campus of Howard University, and we go out to citizens who this impacts the most, who this issue, this subject matter, impacts the most. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be able to have a full-throated discussion about this. And I'd like for you, if you would, to give some historical perspective to the argument.
Thank you, Rock. And first of all, thank you for taking on this issue right now. This is very important. The Rock Newman Show is always on top of the critical issues at the moment. Andrew, very good opening statement. And I like the fact that Andrew came to the conclusion that we need representation. Mm-hmm. Where Andrew and I, and perhaps Ms. Perry, disagree is that we want statehood, not just representation. Mm-hmm. There's a big difference. We have not been struggling with this idea for decades. We've been struggling it since 1801, when the Congress had a debate. What are you gonna do with these 14,000 people who live in this District of Columbia? What are we gonna do with these 14,000 people and their right to vote? They've been struggling with this idea for over 200 years. This is a question of having the right to vote, having a voice in the Congress.
The right to vote, to have representation.
To have a representation in Congress. So if we're going to go to Vietnam, if we're going to go to Afghanistan, if we're going to go to Iraq, we need to have a right to vote as to what our national, domestic, and foreign policy is. However, Andrew also mentioned about the power of Congress. The power of Congress does have the right. The power of Congress in 1846 took back the land, gave back the land of Virginia to Virginia, Alexander and Arlington, got two more representative votes in the Congress as a result of retrocession of that land back to Virginia. Mm-hmm. They have a right to do this. They can create the new Columbia or the new state, whatever we're going
to
call it.
And to keep this very simple, so we all understand.
Yeah.
So there was a section of what was the District of Columbia that was ceded back to Virginia,
correct,
which is now Old Town and the Alexandria area.
Correct.
And so there is precedent for doing that, at least doing that.
And that was the Organic Act of 1801 that made Arlington County, mm-hmm, Arlington County was part of District of Columbia, Washington County, and then two other cities. There was Georgetown City and there was Washington City.
Okay.
In 1871, they all came together as, or it came together as the District of Columbia.
Mm-hmm.
But in fact, Congress has a right to do this. Congress can make these changes. The problem with Andrew's argument is a basic question of fairness. We have voted in 1982 for statehood. We're going to vote again in November the 8th for statehood. This is the will of the people. What does Andrew say about democracy? This is a basic democratic right that we want. We want to be a state. We don't want to be part of Maryland. We don't want to be part of Virginia. We want to be a state. It's a basic question of democracy and the right to vote.
Okay. Ms. Perry, as Dr. Demczuk said, this has now been going on. The issue has been before us, I said decades, let's call it centuries now.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So you, the mayor's office and your people have worked now, obviously tirelessly and successfully, to get it on the ballot. Not all people who are for statehood thought that the mechanism that you all used was the right one. We'll get to that in a minute. But tell us about this campaign to get this on the ballot and why you all fought so aggressively to make it happen now.
Okay, there are several reasons. Number one, thanks for having us and thanks for bringing this issue to the people. But before I say how we did this, I'm amazed in this political climate that my friend would say that the constitutional rights of the citizens of the District of Columbia are tied to the Republican will. But what we did, the mayor said that she wanted to do something different. She said that, over the years, people have Congress, Delegate Norton has introduced a bill for more than two decades. There may have been a hearing or so, as Andrew said, and then Congress ignores it. The D.C. residents, the D.C. leaders would lead a protest, get arrested. She says, Beverly, I do not want to go back to jail. We got to do something different. Find a way to do something different. I met with constitutional law professors around the city. And one professor, Professor Viet Dinh at Georgetown, said, the way you have to do this, you have to follow the Tennessee plan. And what the Tennessee plan is a plan that was used by Tennessee after they were rejected over several years. They decided Congress didn't trust what they would be, whether they would fit the requirements of a state. So they said, let's just meet all the constitutional requirements. The Constitution requires four things for a jurisdiction to become a state. The Constitution requires the citizens of the jurisdiction to ratify that they want to become a state, vote to become a state.
Mm-hmm.
It requires them to ratify a constitution. We have drafted a constitution. It requires them to develop their boundaries. And let me just say, yes, the Constitution requires that there be a federal district. The Constitution does not require what the size has to be. With our state plan, with our statehood plan, the federal jurisdiction is there. It's carved out.
When you say that, we have actually, I think, a map that we can put on screen so that as you're talking about the boundaries,
yes,
the viewers can actually see what you all are proposing.
Right, correct. Okay, so, and the fourth thing that the Constitution requires is that a jurisdiction has to pledge to become an elected form of government, Republican form, small r, form of government that you have to be elected. You can't have royalty with the king.
Sure.
So those are the four things. So we set out in April to develop that plan. Now, as Bernard said, there was a constitution ratified before, but that constitution, it was dated. It had to be updated. It had things in it we knew that Congress would reject. So we were advised to develop a constitution, bare bones, if you will, that comports with all of the U.S. Constitution requirements and embodied all of the laws of the city, carries forth the laws of our city now. We drafted that constitution, and we went to the Board of Elections. We had to develop an advisory referendum. Mm-hmm. The council introduced an advisory referendum. They passed it. They sent it to the Board of Election and asked for it to be on the ballot. That's the referendum B that would be on the ballot. It is a referendum with four parts. It has those four questions, four components that I mm-hmm. just mentioned, mm-hmm. and it has a question at the end, say yes or no, whether or not you vote for it. So that's the plan that we've laid out. The other thing, it's all about political climate. You know, we looked at when President Obama was elected in 2008, Democrats won the House, the Senate, and the White House. If we had had this plan in effect and been able to petition the Congress in 2009, we perhaps could be a state by now. Hmm. We have a political climate now that is leaning in our favor. In addition, this is not statehood for D.C. It is not a D.C. issue. I think in the past we've treated it too much as a D.C. issue. We have almost 700,000 people that their civil rights are being violated. There is no way that your zip code is supposed to disenfranchise you from the policymaking body of this country. And that's what happens. I spoke to a group.
And when you say that, you're talking about really fundamental fairness.
Fundamental fairness that our Constitution, promises to us. We want to be, the people of D.C. want to be treated just like all other Americans. You should not move across that D.C. line and lose the right to vote for a member of the Senate or a voice in the House. A vote in the mm-hmm. House.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have that.
Yeah.
We don't have that.
Yeah. You know, if I could go back again to the beginning, and Bernard, you may be, the best one versed to discuss this, but as we were looking at this subject, to find out how this controversy really came about was to learn that it came about in part that the federal district, that this federal piece of land, that the proponents of it wanted it to be protected and to be federally controlled as a result of a fiasco in Philadelphia where the Congress was surrounded and not able to come out. The congressman in office could not come out. They were held hostage in their congressional houses. And when it was sought for the Philadelphia government and the Pennsylvania government to protect them, well, they weren't so forthcoming in doing so. And so therefore, again, the excuse, one of the reasons given is that, okay, if we come to our Washington, D.C., and we don't have the proper protection of the federal government, and the citizens come up, surround the folks on Congress, and we appeal to Washington, D.C. to protect us, well, their inclination might not be to do so.
Well, Rock, you put your finger on an essential component of what we're trying to do here is our country was born out of protest. We protested taxation without representation. We protested the King of England. We created the District of Columbia out of a protest because you're exactly right. The Pennsylvania militia could not protect the Congress in 1783. They needed a new space. That new space was the District of Columbia. That new space now today, however, is not protected by just one militia. There are 18 different police forces here in the District of Columbia that can very well protect the United States Congress. So that argument that we need to be protected, that the District of Columbia needs to be protected, goes out the window today. It's a whole different time. As a matter of fact, the idea that we have a right to protest and have a right to demand what is absolutely our right, no taxation without representation. This is what the statehood movement is about. This is why we want the right to vote. Andrew has to deal with this question of us having a right to vote. I mean, certainly having a representative in the House is a good step forward, but that's not what we want. What we want are two senators in the United States Senate and one in the House, and that gives us equal representation.
Andrew?
I'm doing a two-on-one here, so I'm trying to figure out who to respond to first, but I guess I'll start with what Bernard said, that the he said, you know, the question is, D.C. residents deserve the right to vote. And as I said, I agree. But as you mentioned in the beginning, Bernard, that's not what we're talking here. We're talking about D.C. statehood. Does every American deserve the right to have two senators and congressmen or a congresswoman? Yes. Every American does not have the right to make a state. We've seen tons of statehood movements in the past in California, in Colorado, in Arizona, of people trying to carve out their own states, saying that, you know, the elites in the big cities aren't representing us appropriately. These movements have all fizzled out, but I don't think anyone argued they have a constitutional right to do so. The question is, how do we get residents of our city the right to have representation in Congress? And, you know, again, back to my original comment about the retrocession, that would be the far easier way to...
And again, you know, you've said it, but I want it to be very clear. Part of what you and those who support your position are saying, when you say retro, you're talking about parts of D.C. becoming Maryland and Virginia. And Andrew, I'm going to tell you, there are probably some folks sitting out there in Washington, D.C. right now throwing beer cans at the TV.
And Maryland, too. They don't want us.
Maryland doesn't want us. And we don't want them.
Well, a couple things.
As much as I love Maryland.
I mean, the Washington Redskins play in Maryland.
We don't say the R word.
to that I would say, I get that, you know, it's, and actually Mayor Bowser was asked this on Meet the Press a few months ago. Chuck Todd, they were discussing D.C. statehood, and Chuck Todd said, you know, honestly, isn't the easier way to get this goal, if the goal is truly only to give D.C. residents representation in Congress, wouldn't the easier way to be to give retrocession back to Virginia and to Maryland? And Mayor Bowser said, well, you know, no, but the only strong reason she gave was because we're Washington, D.C. I agree. I've lived here for 10 years. I'm a D.C. resident. I love the city. But I don't think that we should be concerned that changing the political boundaries of who your congressperson or congresswoman is in Congress would somehow destroy or alter the function of D.C. Just like, you know, you can take New York City, for example. New York City, the greater metropolitan area, encompasses New Jersey and New York, New York State. But the city still has that core identity. D.C., I think, has built up a similar identity over the course of the past several decades. So I don't think we should be afraid that somehow, you know, altering our borders in terms of who my congressperson would be would somehow transform the district into something less than what it is.
Are right you now. Afraid of that?
No, I'm not afraid of that. But I mean, it, to us, it really doesn't make sense. So you would give us to a state that already have two senators. We have no voice in that. So you're going to disenfranchise us in a different way, that you're going to just give us to other senators. No, that's not acceptable. No one has ever done that. And with respect to, people in other states that want to get segmented from that state, they are already part of a state. We've never been part of a state. So we're looking for statehood for the first time. And, you know, just like Tennessee did, just like Alaska did in 1959. You know, you could have said the same thing to Alaska. They are out there. Why should they become a state? Why should they get two senators? What? They did.
So you mentioned political climate.
Yes.
And you said that had this been put on a ballot and approved before, when Obama got in, and so he had the executive office, he had Congress, he had the Senate, mm-hmm. that perhaps you would already be a state. And you said the timing is important in terms of political climate.
Yes.
So now I'm thinking that you are anticipating and looking at the polls that Hillary Clinton is going to win. And so when you say the political climate is good, does that factor in?
Yes, and not only is that prediction correct, but Secretary Clinton has already said, she issued a press release and said that she will be the number one advocate for statehood. So our political climate is favorable right now.
Mm-hmm. You said that prediction is correct. Andrew might disagree.
Well, I'm not going to make a prediction on who's going to win, but yes, Hillary Clinton has come out in support of D.C. statehood. She conveniently wrote that in an op-ed just a few weeks before the D.C. primary. So knowing what we know about her political convictions, or in my opinion, a lack thereof, I would take that with a grain of salt. And we've seen this with President Obama as well. I think politicians, it's very easy to say you agree with D.C. statehood in the broad sense when you're not presented with the real-world implications of what that would mean. Polls show that obviously residents of D.C. support it. Nationally, it has some support as well. But I think when you start actually addressing these real-world implications, how would it be done? What would the state look like? How would that alter the balance of power? A lot of these cold realities start coming into play, and I think that the support would weaken. And my last point, she mentioned earlier that she said it's sad that the will of Republicans in Congress are the ones who are stopping this. It's not just Republicans. Democrats have been fighting this as well. And when this came up for vote in the Congress in 1993, 100 Democrats in the House voted against this as well because they were concerned with, what would this actually look like? So to argue that this is a cut and dry partisan issue, I don't think is honest.
Well, the fact is, however, that Tennessee was a territory. Congress gave the right of Tennessee to vote for its statehood. 10 other states did that. That is what we're looking for. We're looking for the right to vote, regardless of Andrew, there are smart people in the District of Columbia at Howard University and Georgetown and GW and AU, and all the citizens will come together and figure out these thorny issues. You're correct about the thorny issues. We have a thorny issue of what is going to be the name of our state. Is it New Columbia, named after perhaps the, well, not perhaps, the person who started the Atlantic slave trade, Christopher Columbus? Should it be New Columbia, or can it be Anacostia, or can it be Potomac, or can it be Douglas, or whatever?
Or Washington, D.C.
Or Washington, or New Washington. Those are minor issues. The basic issue is, do we have a right to have a vote and voice like Alaska, like Hawaii, like Tennessee, like California? We want that right.
It's a civil rights issue, and it's a national issue. It is, when you look at it, if you have 700,000 people that are disenfranchised, and by the way, we are larger than the population of two other states. We pay more taxes than 22 states. We pay the highest taxes per capita than any state. So,
And we die in wars.
And we die in wars, just like we participate in the armed services. We do our share. We do everything that people in other states. Yet, the Supreme Court is missing one of its members, and the U.S. Senate will confirm someone. We don't have anybody to call to express an opinion about that. Mm-hmm. That is a civil rights violation.
If we can put the map back up again, please. There are, and what this initiative that is on the ballot now, it is developed to the point where it carves out, it takes away one of the arguments, Andrew, of the federal government having its own space that it can correct. I think that Bernard made the point, there are 18 different police forces here that would protect against any sort of anarchy. But even with that, your initiative is comprehensive to the point that it carves out still a federal area. With this up on the screen, can you talk to us about where the boundaries are?
Yes, the boundaries are from Capitol Hill, the east side of the Capitol, mm-hmm. to the Kennedy Center.
Uh-huh. So up the mall.
So basically, there were three criteria in developing the boundaries. The boundaries incorporated in the new state, and by the way, the council has changed the name of the new state to the state of Washington, D.C. D.C. represents Douglas Commonwealth. So the Office of Plan and developed three criteria for the boundaries. One is that all residents would be included in the state of Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. That all of the primary federal facilities, cabinet agencies, would be incorporated in the federal district. Mm-hmm. So everything from the Capitol. The only resident in the federal district would be the president, the residence at the White House.
Uh-huh. And it's called the federal enclave. Uh-huh. It's a federal enclave. There's nobody lives in there. Where people live is yeah. in the state of New Washington,
D.C. So again, so we're talking the Capitol to the east yes. and south, mm-hmm. coming up the mall. Incorporating the White House, mm-hmm. the Ellipse, mm-hmm. incorporating all of that.
Jefferson Memorial.
Jefferson. Lincoln.
All of the major monuments.
Memorial, yes.
Rock Creek Park.
Going to the monument, where the Vietnam Memorial is, the World War II Memorial, mm-hmm. going back to, all the way to where Martin Luther King gave the speech on mm-hmm. the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. Right. That's it.
And it comes
around by the water, which is just behind, extends out to the water, which is just behind the Jefferson Memorial.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So that's the area where basically you're saying no one is a resident in that area. That's very interesting.
Yes.
So whoever's in the White House, they got a lot of land.
Disenfranchised.
With their crib. Right.
Well, the irony is that we are the beacon of justice and democracy and equality in the world. Yeah. You know, in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, the Soviet Union used against us, look what you're doing to black people in America. They can't even sit at a lunch counter. They can't ride on a bus. They can't use the libraries. Yeah. They use that against us. There is no capital in the world that denies its residents the right to vote. We're the only one. That's an embarrassment. It's an embarrassment internationally. And I think Andrew has to deal with this very fundamental question, and that is, and I respect his loyalty to his party, he is a Republican, and that's fine, and he's a good Republican. I like this kind of a Republican. Andrew is loyal, and I respect it. The fact is, however, Andrew knows, and the Republican Party knows, that we will get two Democratic senators in the District of Columbia, our new state, and we will get one Democratic member of the House. Now, maybe in 20 years, the demographics will shift, and maybe it'll be the other way. Mm-hmm. But in fact, the Republican Party is blocking this because they fear more Democrats in the Congress.
And I want to say this, sitting from this chair, that to the extent that that is a compelling argument, whether or not it's acknowledged or not, is something that I think when people sit and talk about fairness, and you know, we've heard the taxation without representation. I don't think at this table here today it's been extended to say the taxation without representation is tyranny. It always was and it always will be. That I think where it really rubs fair-minded people the most is that whether it was a Democrat or whether it was a Republican that would put that kind of ideology before the best interest of almost 700,000 people. Do you acknowledge, Andrew, that that's a morally indefensible position?
I think if your sole reason for voting against D.C. statehood is because you want to keep Republican control in the Senate or prevent two Democrats from being in the Senate, is not a morally defensible position. Mm-hmm. Again, though, I think part of this is the political reality. If you're asking American citizens who live 3,000 miles away, on the West Coast, where I'm from originally, this issue is very foreign to them in the sense that it's happening very far away. They don't live in the District of Columbia. They might not have been to the District of Columbia. And the question to them is, do we feel this is worth it to shift the balance of power? I just think as a reality, that's something that they have to consider. But again, I don't think that's the strongest argument against D.C. statehood. And I want to go back briefly to what we were discussing earlier about the mutiny of 1786 and and the Capitol in Philadelphia being surrounded by militia. Mm-hmm. You said that argument is no longer effective. I respectfully disagree. Mm-hmm. I do think that it is unlikely to imagine a horde of militiamen with guns and pitchforks coming around the Capitol and demanding they be paid their pensions. Well, maybe that could happen. Politics have been strange this year.
Yeah.
But I think it wasn't just a question of physical control and safety. And James Madison wrote about this a lot in the Federalist Papers. He said that he was worried that a state that contained the Capitol would have what we call disturbing influence. And by that, I mean that it would be a state that would be the only state in the Union whose chief industry and chief economic engine is the federal government. I came across an interesting study a couple weeks ago that found that 52% of all jobs in the District of Columbia either are employed by the federal government or can be tangentially related to federal government activities, spending, lobbying, et cetera, et cetera. That's really a shocking statistic, not for us, because we live here, but for folks who live on other parts of the country who already have, unpopular opinions about the federal government. It really goes to show that the city has been built around the levers of power in Congress, in the White House, in the executive branch, et cetera. So if D.C. were to become a state, if we were to ignore all the constitutional and political arguments against it, it would by nature be kind of the odd man out in the sense of, well, the 50 states were established, on their own accord. We were the state that essentially ignored or revised the Constitution to become a state, but we still are the operating seat of the federal government. So I think the map that they drew out, that it does contain the Capitol and the White House, it is, yes, essentially a district, but it's essentially a park. It's a park. It's the National Mall, it's the Capitol, it's the White House, and all of these federal jobs would all be in the District of Columbia. Now, that would bring a lot of perks, I think, for the state of D.C., but it would also, again, go back to that point of undue influence. And as a conservative, we see, and again, going back to the partisan times that we live in, I can count on both hands cases of attorneys general in states who, for whatever reason, refuse to defend laws that they're obligated to in court because of a political agenda. Whether that's right or wrong, that's fine, but it's not hard to imagine there becoming a conflict of interest with the elected officials in D.C. as it relates to the goings-on of the federal government. And that should be a concern for everyone, both parties.
But, Rock, I think what Andrew is saying is it just demonstrates what our job is, our educational job for America, and that's why I say it's an American issue. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, when I went to Cleveland, Ohio, to the Republican convention, and I told the chairman of the Republican Party in Ohio that we are disenfranchised from the Congress, he said, that can't be. This is America. I mean, when we talk to Republicans in Ohio about the plight
of the RNC, the head of the RNC, Ryan Scribus?
No, it was the committee man.
Okay.
The committee man
okay.
for Ohio. Mm-hmm. He said, it cannot be that you are you don't have a vote in Congress. This is America. Everybody has a senator. And people are surprised when we tell them that we don't have two senators. But let me just speak to the point that he talked about. First of all the cabinet agencies, Department of Justice, Department of States, Department of Agriculture, all those jobs are in the federal district. It's not true. All of the major cabinet areas are within, will remain in the federal district.
As you've proposed.
As the map is proposed. Mm-hmm. But talking about the federal employees coming into the city to work, do you know who paid for mm-hmm. those employees to come into the city? Do you know our taxes are probably higher because we have to pay for them? We talked about this last week when we were talking about regional funding for Metro. Mm-hmm. And the people in Virginia said, Governor McCullough, he said, yes, of course I support statehood. He said, if we had two more senators, if we had statehood, we would have two more senators, we would have an additional vote in the House, and the federal underpayment for Metro funding would probably be less likely. Mm-hmm. We would have more forces.
Just as a practical
matter. As a practical matter. It is important to the region to have two more senators. We have all of this population paying all these taxes, and yet you know, we don't have the voices that we should have. So, I mean, an economic reason for having two more senators is because we are so underpaid on metro funding. And we all know that's an issue.
When you talk about the initiative now, you guys quickly say that it's not just a D.C. problem. It is an American problem. It is the problem of America. Andrew makes the point that someone on the West Coast just might not be so interested to be engaged in something that's happening here in the nation's capital. It seemed the effort to educate and to get engagement seems to be a yeoman's effort.
And by the way, I also wanted to mention that the co-chair of the Statehood Yes campaign is George Vredenburg, a conservative Republican. This is the first time that the statehood movement has had bipartisan appeal. So we're going to win you over, Andrew, okay?
Back to Andrew's California roots. As a matter of fact, Andrew, a recent poll last year showed 78% of Americans think that we have a vote in Congress. When we tell them we don't, 82% say that we should. And most Americans think that we do not pay federal taxes. The question becomes that we need a massive nationwide educational process because a lot of people, Andrew, your arguments are majoring in minors. These are minor problems that you're raising issues, and you're raising correct issues, but they don't compare to the fact that we do not have the right to vote. Fundamental fairness has denied us, denied you in the nation's capital because you live here.
And the one thing that I can tell you that everybody believes in, I believe all Americans believe this, all Americans should be treated equally. Mm-hmm. We should be treated the same. We are not. And that's the point. So when you lay it out for Americans, whether they're on the West Coast, whether they're in Alaska, wherever they're from, that we are treated differently with our enfranchisement. Mm-hmm. When we lay that out, people said, that is not right. You should be treated equally.
So, you know, again, to circle back to the point I made in the beginning, we're talking about whether or not members, residents of D.C. should have the right to vote in Congress. I think we're all in agreement here, but then the conversation keeps on turning back to the idea of, well, let's make D.C. a state. I think that's a distraction. As you said, you know, there has been a very impressive effort on behalf of the D.C. government in the past couple of months and years to lobby Congress, to lobby both parties. They were at the RNC in Cleveland. They were at the DNC in Philadelphia, making the points to both sides. They've been trying to raise awareness. They've been trying to raise money on this issue. And I think it's a great effort for a good cause. I just think it's being misguided down the wrong direction. D.C. statehood is not going to happen politically. It's not going to happen constitutionally. And if we're all saying that it is shocking that we don't have the right to vote in Congress, the easiest way to get that done, the easiest way to talk to our neighbors, Virginia and Maryland, as opposed to having to go to every state in the union and making the pitch, is saying, can we start having some of these DC neighborhoods go back to the states where they initially came from? I think that's the easiest way to get this done. I think what will happen is I think the ballot measure will pass in November overwhelmingly. We'll petition it to Congress, and it will once again die in Congress. Maybe if the Congress becomes overwhelmingly blue this year, it might pass. We'll see a long court battle. And by 2020, 2021, I think we'll be right back where we started at this table debating how do we get DC residents the right to vote. So the best way to get this done, Rock, is to just look at the easy solution in front of us. And let's put some of the district back to Maryland, back to Virginia. We're still residents of D.C. We still have that D.C. pride. We still have our sport teams. But at least we have someone in Congress who we can call our own.
You know, as I sit here, someone who owned property here in the District of Columbia for, I think it was like 34 years, and being so closely identified with D.C., when I hear the talk of ceding back some of the land of D.C. to Virginia or from Maryland, that strikes me and is about as appealing to me as a 6'8" guy saying he wants to come in my house and kiss my wife. That's a tough one to swallow. That's really, really a tough one to swallow. And I was born in D.C. I'm a Howard University grad. I identify so much with Washington, D.C. Right now, I happen to live across the line. But still, that D.C. identity that I feel, the thought of taking and splitting it up and giving a little bit back to Maryland and giving a little bit back to Virginia. And I bring that up because I think that if D.C. residents were to be polled, a lot of them wouldn't want their wives or husbands kissed by that 6'8" guy.
I think Rock, that Dr. King taught us long time ago that justice delayed is justice denied. What I think Andrew wants to do is delay. We can't delay the end of slavery. We can't delay the end of Jim Crow. We cannot delay the fact that we are not treated equal like California residents. We want to be treated equally, period.
And since Bernard invoked Dr. King's name, Dr. King said in his letter from the Birmingham jail, if something affects one of us directly, it affects all of us indirectly. Mm-hmm. So I say it's an American problem. It's not a
Jesus. So we're talking about Dr. King, the moral arc of the universe.
Yes.
Is long, but it bends towards justice.
That's right.
Andrew, you're about to say.
I would look at the camera, whichever camera is on, and ask the residents who are watching your show. This is not new talk. We've been talking about this for a very long time.
Since 1801.
Again and again and again and again and again and again, and every time we get excited and every time the effort fails. Instead of trying this yet again, why don't we combine all of our effort and our energy for something new? And I honestly can't stand here and say it will work. Mm-hmm. I don't know, and I totally agree. The argument of breaking up DC, as far as the boundaries go, is an emotional argument. It's not fun to imagine. But I think if you really think about, I don't think most Americans, regardless of what state you're in, identify themselves with what congressional district they're in. Most Americans can't even name their congressperson. But I think that would be the best way to preserve DC's unique status as our nation's capital, to respect the Constitution, which has clearly spelled out what it intended for the District of Columbia to be, and also give everyone living in the city access to a congressperson and two senators like we're all saying that they should.
In terms of, the Constitution has been mentioned several times here. Would there have to be a change to the Constitution?
No.
You say no, do you say
no.
Yes?
No, because the Congress still would have ultimate authority over the District of Columbia, over the federal enclave. Mm-hmm. That's what they want. Mm-hmm. And that's it. That's in the Constitution, and we don't disagree with that. Mm-hmm. We are just going to carve out the way Congress carved out Virginia in 1846, mm-hmm. can carve out the state of Anacostia, the state of New D.C., mm-hmm. New Washington.
And I can tell you, the con law professor that I mentioned from Georgetown University, Via Den, has written a whole paper on it. There is an argument that the 23rd Amendment that gave D.C. the 3 electoral votes would have to be changed, and he has written a whole paper to say that's not true, and it lays out all the reasons why that's not true.
So we are just mere days from November 8th, and there is obviously what so many are calling. They always do this, but or if there's ever an argument to me, this is one of the most pivotal presidential elections in our lifetime. Andrew, I ask you specifically, as a Republican, were you supporting Trump? Were you supporting the nominee? I think your answer was...
I said tepidly.
Tepidly, so okay. I didn't want to throw you under the bus.
No.
But since you said it, you said tepidly so. So because this is such an important decision for all Americans, make your case if you would. We've got about 6 minutes left. Make your case if you would. Why Donald Trump would be better as the leader of this country than Hillary Clinton?
Sure. Well, I always start these conversations. I get asked by a lot of my more liberal friends, why are you voting for Trump, or are you voting for Trump? And so I'm used to having this conversation a lot. Mm-hmm. the first thing I would say is that I'm honestly not voting for Donald Trump. I did not support him in the primary. I was very upset when he won the nomination. And I think it's been an ugly election on both sides. And I don't think having either of these candidates has been doing a true public service for the party. But you know, the way I look at my vote, and this is different from how other people view their vote, obviously it's their vote, they can do whatever they want. I view my vote as a statement. A statement for what direction I want the country to go in. And I've obviously, as a Republican, not been happy with the past 8 years. I've not been happy with the direction that the current Democratic Party is heading in. And I frankly think that Secretary Clinton has gotten away with not having to discuss her policy positions on some issues because all the media's focus has been on Trump, and rightfully so, because he has said some bizarre, entertaining, and offensive things. So I'm not so much, when I cast my ballot, I'm not so much voting for Donald Trump, is I'm voting for change. And you know, let's assume Donald Trump wins. If on November 9th he wins, I might wake up and be like, all right, I have a lot of work to do to hold him accountable, to make sure that he is held accountable on conservative policy goals. But I think that will be a watershed moment in saying that, you know, the American people are finally speaking up, saying that we don't like the direction the country's going in. We don't like the way that the current establishment is running Congress, the White House, et cetera. And so that would be how I will frame my vote on November 8th.
You know, some folks out there watching tonight might just come to the same conclusion that Bernard did a little earlier. You know, you're a pretty good Republican guy.
I try to be reasonable.
Beverly, I want to come back to you on something, but Bernard, I want to ask you to make the case. Obviously, you're supporting Hillary Clinton. He just talked about not so much voting for Trump, but voting for change. And why should one be voting for Hillary Clinton?
I think Hillary Clinton has the experience, has the politics, has the best interest of the country, particularly the country that is hurting. I think that one of the values of Donald Trump has been able to expose the pain that exists in the Ohio Valley in Appalachia among white working class who are not, because the Rust Belt, because the jobs have gone mm-hmm. away, mm-hmm. That Hillary has a plan after she gets elected to go to these valleys, to go to these communities, and to begin to deal with putting people back to work. I think that Trump has done a good job in exposing that. I think Hillary is the person that can make this happen.
Mm-hmm. Stronger together.
Stronger together.
Yeah. Beverly, back to, because you as a DC employee can't necessarily advocate for one candidate or the other, right?
I cannot.
Okay. All right, I'm going to respect that. So, again, something that you've put so much time into, this initiative that you all really struggled, fought, kept your nose to the grind, shoulder to the wheel to get on the ballot. I think what I'd like for you to do is to explain in the most simple terms, those who are looking, who are going to be voting in just a few days, why it's so important, I'm trying to wrap this show up, that they vote in favor of your initiative.
Well, there is an editorial in the Post by Ann Laucow, and she says, we're a colonial state. If, you know, we don't have total control over our budget, over anything. Congress can change anything we do. And we have proven over the past years, for more than 20 years now, we have balanced our budget. We have proven, as a matter of fact, we are in financial conditions that most states envy. Our schools are improving at a number one rate. We got it right. You know, we have had some times in our history, but we have gotten our jurisdiction right. And we are disenfranchised. Now, as Andrew said, yeah, there was a time that statehood was not as favorable because people thought we couldn't manage. Mm-hmm. We have proven now that we are good stewards of our resources, and we manage well, we are growing, and people want to live here. And people that want to live here, we're gaining 1,000 people a month. Within the next two decades, we will be 1 million strong. can you have a million Americans that are disenfranchised from their policy-making body? I don't think so. I don't think so. And I don't think you can take a million people and give them to someone else. I mean, that logic
that
really—
That dog don't hunt?
That dog does not hunt. you can't just take a million people and give them to someone. We have a fundamental right. It's a civil rights issue. And it's a civil rights issue as a jurisdiction, as a people. And I think all Americans should be concerned that if we can be disenfranchised in this way, there is something that can happen to all of us.
I really want to thank the three of you for coming in here today. I wish, and we're going to do all that we can, to make sure that as many Americans as possible are able to watch this program. This has been educational, it's been informative, it's been most civilized. I wish our presidential dialogue could have this kind of discussion. Again, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. God bless and goodbye. I'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.